Good morning, my dear friends, and welcome to the Folklore Garden with your host, Sam Bittman. Today, I think we're going to do a couple of interesting things. I hope you'll find them interesting anyway. First thing we're going to do is prepare a modified French intensive planting bed. And then after that, we're going to plant some cabbage family crops called cruciferae, which I'll talk about a little later. I'll mention today is May 6th, and we've had a little bit of a warm-up, and things are starting to pop, but we're expecting snow on Saturday, so who knows what happens in the Berkshires in the garden. We've got early salad greens, see some spinach and radish. The garlic is doing beautifully. Daffodils are gorgeous, aren't they? Tulips are up and open, and the orchard is getting ready to pop. And remember the peas we planted, and I told you that we got them real thick, and they're up out of the ground. It's really fantastic. And pretty soon, they're going to be up, and their tendrils will start to spread, and they're going to grasp onto those branches and set flowers and then set pods, and boy, oh boy, are we going to be in for some crop of peas. So just a little background on this modified intensive method that I'm using in this garden, which is called biointensive. And anyway, that phrase comes from Alan Chadwick, who was a great British horticulturist and agronomist. And he took it and combined the names of what Rudolf Steiner created as biodynamic agriculture in the 1920s, and from the techniques of French market growers in the 19th century and before. And he put them together and called it biointensive. And the whole point here is to get the soil so rich and so productive and so full of life that anything you put in it to grow is grown quickly. And that's the essence of producing really healthy food. And so I'm going to demonstrate on just a very small bed that needs some preparation, because I haven't attended for it and I haven't done that double digging there for a few years. So I'll show you on a small bed exactly how we do it and why there's so much work attached to it. Okay, so this is a simple process. It does take a little labor, so I would limber up a little bit if I were you. But this is a bed that's 4 feet by 5 feet. And I want to tell you something. When you prepare a bed the way I'm going to do it, you can grow a ton of food in here. Okay. First thing I'm going to do is I'm going to spread some compost all across. Next thing I'm going to do, my magic mix. I'm going to just do a little bit of that. Sprinkle across the top. Remember, this contains all our majoring components for plant life: nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, and some micronutrients as well. And now starts the work. I'm going to dig a trench. and I'm going to go across this way. And although we don't normally step, we don't try not to step on this soil because it can squish microbial life. I am going to do a little stepping on it because I'm going to be digging it as we go along. So I'm going to turn the first level. I'm going across. I'm turning that over. A rock under there. Okay, now I'm going to take that top shovel full of soil and I am going to put it in this bucket because that's going to go somewhere else in a little bit. This method was taught to me, by the way, by some folks who were apprentices of Alan Chadwick and later John Jevons, who wrote How to Grow More Vegetables Than You Ever Thought Possible on Less Land Than You Can Imagine. And this was the basis of that assertion. That book is translated into many languages and was the Whoa, what do I got here? I got a rock that looks just like a potato. okay, so I'm just about down to that first layer. Now, I'm going to put this shovel down into that bottom. And I'm just going to not turn it, but loosen it. Now that allows air to get down into the soil, which is important. It's going to allow more friable soil for roots to go down, and also for nutrients to make their way down. Now, I am going to add to the bottom of that trench some fresh horse manure. And if you know anything about French horse manure, you know that it's very hot. It can get very hot. And that's what we want, because that's just like putting a heating pad under the plants and it'll just make them just jump. Now I'm going to go to the next row and turn it over on top of the manure. You may think, this is a lot of work for raising some plants, but I want to tell you something. If you adhere to the notion that you leave this planet in better shape than you find it, there's no better way to do it than this. And now I'm in the bottom of the second trench, and I loosen that up. Again, we're going essentially to another spade's depth. So we're literally two spades down from grade, which is about 20, 24 inches. Okay. Some more poop. And now I'm going to turn the next row onto that poop. Now, we'll do this one more time. And I want you to notice the level of the soil over here at this point and the level of the soil over there. And when we're done, we'll do a comparison. Whoop. Okay. A 4x5 bed, fortunately, is not very large, which means that we can get pretty much a bunch done fairly quickly. Now again, remember that this is not brand new ground. And when you're doing French intensive method, or an approach, as you call it, you want to make sure to renew the beds in this style every 3 years or so. In the interim period, the underneath is so rich that all you need to do is amend the surface. Smells good too. This is actually quite fresh from the stable. My good buddy who works with me here has a horse farm, and so this stuff is in steady supply. Okay, almost done. I call it a modified method because I continually modify it the older I get. And I'm about as old as dirt, so I keep getting more modified and, oops, didn't mean to turn that, but loosen it. You can see the clay down there. It's a good productive clay, but it's clay and less fertile than loam. Almost done. How boring is this getting, folks? Not too bad, I hope. I am really just about done. That's the last trench, pretty much. We're going to loosen it up on the bottom. Now, you say, how are we going to fill that? And we go and we get the first bucket we dug. Now, we do have to smooth it out, but if you'll notice how higher than grade this bed is than it was when we first started, you'll see that that's what we've actually done, is we've fluffed this whole thing up, and that soil that we're going to plant in is just in top form. Now, of course, I've got to get clumps out and stuff, but that's basically it. French intensive. Feed the ground will feed you. Okay, now we're going to go do some planting just over yonder. In this bed, we're going to plant some broccoli and a very favorite variety of mine called Arcadia. The broccoli and kale and collards and cabbage and all Brussels sprouts are all in the same family, the Latin name for which is cruciferae. And the reason they call them cruciferae is because the blossoms, when they do blossom out, and sometimes you don't want them to blossom, but if they do, they're in little cross-like shapes. And another name that we call this family is by brassicas. So I've got six Arcadia plants here that I'm going to plant, and they were started in peat pots and kind of grown in there. You can see the kind of the roots have kind of bound together a little bit, but that's easy enough to deal with. Break them off. Break them off. And there you go. And they all have a section, a good and healthy section of root. And one of the things that I do with all crucifers is that I break off almost all the leaves. And not to worry about that, they come back full, and that's mainly to kind of give them a nice balance. Another thing that I do, and this goes back to an old piece of folklore I learned a long time ago, which is that you wrap the stems in a kind of a newspaper gird, kind of, before you plant them. Now, that is to protect against an insect called cutworms. Now, years ago in this garden, there was, right through where I am, a 3-foot-wide grass walkway. And cutworms tend to hang around in soil that's been recently desodded. Now, I'm still a little worried about it, even though it's been several years. But here's what we're going to do. I'm going to dig a hole. I'm going to put in a scoop full or two of compost. Wrap my crucifer in newspaper and wrap it almost, and I should say bury it almost to its neck. And by the way, I'm spacing these about 18 inches apart, and you'll see when the season gets going, these babies spread out. Get me another wrap of newspaper don't worry about it. The newspaper's not going to stifle or smother or do anything. Get it down in deep. Set it up right, straight, because the broccoli will have big roots and it will have a large top, a lot of greens and a lot of flower and the broccoli head itself. So the stem has to hold a lot of weight. Okay, just continuing along the way. Notice that I'm planting them in a diagonal fashion. And that's partly because it can, maybe it doesn't do so much in this particular diagram, but the diamond-shaped planting tends to get better use of ground. But I have another little thing I want to try on the sides of the beds when we get done here. Okay, little newspaper collar. And now we're going to put in just a few cabbage plants, which will be my early planting. This is called a variety called Fryo. And I'm going to do the very same thing I did with the broccoli plants, which is to take off the outer leaves. Put a little newspaper collar, got to be a narrow one here, around the bottom. Dig my hole, lay in compost. And now cabbage has some pretty strong roots as well and carries weight. These cabbages are not that big, but they'll weigh about 5 pounds. By the way, we are spacing all of these about 18 inches apart, if I haven't said that before. If I did, forgive the blundering. Okay, off with the outer leaves. On with a narrow little collar. You know, they say, by the way, about cabbage, that if you eat cabbage on New Year's Day, it will be a wealthy year for you. So, there is some other folklore about putting money in cabbage on New Year's Day, wrapping it up, coins, I think, and that will also guarantee you a wealthy year. However, if it doesn't work for you, don't come looking for me. And this final of four that I'm going to lay in now. Cutworms, by the way, can be a total drag. I remember early on in my gardening career coming out after planting, a dozen cabbages and broccoli and so forth, and they were all lying on their sides the next morning, dead, cut off at the ground level. I asked a neighbor, I said, "What the heck is that?" And he said, "Cutworm." So ever since, I have been extremely attentive to the potential destruction of cutworms. Okay, here's another little trick that I use, and it's part of the whole companion planting thing that I'm conscious of, what goes well with what for a variety of reasons. One of the things that we try to avoid or deter in the plantings of brassicas is the flea beetle. And so I'm going to be planting some onion sets in between here, and I'll grow them for scallions just until they have a fairly green top and a thin bottom, and I'll be pulling them before these broccoli and cabbage interfere with their growth. And all you do is you just stick them in the ground to their full depth with the root side down, with the root side down. And I can get a bunch in here because there's a lot of ground right now that's really not being used. And scallions are fabulous for salads, as you know. You can tell I'm just putting them any which way, and I'll finish these up later. But I guarantee you that when these guys start to grow and you see the scallions popping up, these little onion sets are like miniature onions, and the first thing they want to do is put out a green top, and then when they're ready, whoosh, you just pull them out of the ground. The initial body of this onion bulb rots away, and in the center is a pure, clear white, delicious tasting scallion. Okay, I'm going to water these newly planted plants in. And you'll notice that one of the things I've done here is I've created little wells around each plant, and that's going to be good to reserve the water flow. So here we go. We're going to just soak them in. Can see how the water wells up in there, and that's great for the plant roots because they'll just keep moist, and that's what we want. Again, remember the rule of thumb is you've got to grow plants quickly. That's when they'll be the most nutritious and the most flavorful. Well, dear friends, that is episode 3 of Folklore Gardening with your host. However, I wanted to mention again that we did ask for questions And this week we actually had two questions. They're fairly simple to answer. One was, hey, Sam, when are those peas going to sprout? And I think you've already seen that they have. And the second question comes from Isabel, 4 years old, from New York, who wanted to know when episode 3 would be aired. Isabel, it's coming your way. So, ladies and gentlemen, my dear friends, remember, this is Sam Bittman telling you that if you freak out, and it's okay to freak out from time to time, but always remember, when the world wearies and ceases to satisfy, there's always the garden. Thank you.